A little while ago, I was in Canada for a conference of Nigerians. It was a gathering of different congregations, and I had a wonderful time with them. But the last day, we had a book table, and I had books. And what I wanted to do was, you know, put a scripture and encourage these wonderful Nigerians who were so passionate for the Lord. But, you know, when the people came up to me, I hit a problem. Here's what it was. People would come up, and I'd say, "And your name?" And the guy would say, "Lananokolo." And I'd be kind of stymied. And then I'd look, and the wife was there, and she'd say, "Koto Motubu." And the line of people, that's what it was. I was stuck. But a lady came over and she said, "Here, let me help you." And I didn't know how to spell it. I didn't know the pronunciation. But you know what? Somebody came and helped me because I had the desire to be a blessing and help, but I needed somebody to equip and help me on the path. Now, that's what this is all about in lifestyle evangelism. I am drawing from my life lessons and the scriptures to inspire you and equip you. Now, let's remember this. There are two appointments that all of us face in life. You can't get out of them. You might get out of a dentist appointment or whatever, but in Hebrews 9, it says, it's appointed unto a man once to die, and after death, the judgment. And you know what? You don't like to think about it, but you know, people get old. And and you think, well, I'll think about these kind of things once I get old. No, we need to think about things now and help people to do so. I remember I heard this guy, he went on a vacation and he kind of, you know, unplugged. And then when he got back, he was going through his messages. And it was kind of funny, but serious. He said, he saw the doctor called him and he called the doctor back and he said, "Yeah, doc, you called me. I'm catching up on my messages." And the doctor said, "Oh, yeah." He said, I called because I have some really bad news for you. He says, "The test came back and you have serious lymphoma, stage 4. You've got 2 weeks to live." And the guy was shocked. It was a jaw dropper. And he said, "2 weeks to live? What could be worse than that?" And the doctor said, "Well, you know, when I called, that was 2 weeks ago." Now, that's a little joke, but you know what? Life is short. And a lot of people want to avoid the topic of the afterlife. They don't want to talk about it. They live in denial and they say, "Let's not go there." But you know what? I read recently that cremation, there's been a seismic cultural shift with cremation. 4 decades ago, there were less than 5% of Americans that were cremated. You know what it is today? It's almost 50%. And a lot of people, when you talk to them, they say, "Well, I believe that after this life, who cares? That's all there is." You know, or they say, you know, "These are deceptions. God's a God of love. And everybody goes to heaven." You even have some heretics in Christendom say that. Or people say, "All religions are valid. Everyone's saved as long as you're sincere. Hey, just be a good person, do good deeds. You know, the physical realm, that's the only reality." You know, or we live on through the memories of loved ones and our good works. Or people believe in reincarnation. Now, that's false. It's appointed unto a man once to die. And some people say, "I don't believe in hell. And I don't believe God sends anybody there. Except, well, maybe Hitler or a mass murderer." This is deception. So what's God's answer, his antidote for this massive deception? And in this video, we're going to deal with the message. What is God's message to us? And then what's his message through us to the world? So let's start with this. The first one, God's message to us as Christians. Now, in the Old Testament, Isaiah was the greatest of the writing prophets. You know what his name means? It means the Lord saves. And if you read in Isaiah 6, he had a divine visitation, encounter with the Lord. It was spectacular. And after God cleansed his lips, the Lord said, "I want to send somebody." And, you know, who's going to go? And Isaiah said, "I'll go." Well, you know what? That's the sending part of the Christian life. That doesn't mean we go to Zimbabwe or, you know, Syria, but we're sent out into the highways and byways, our private world. And now in the New Testament, Paul, the greatest of the apostolic workers and writers, you know, his name was changed from Saul to Paul, meaning small. And he had that same supernatural experience. He was converted. And in Acts 26, you can read some of the statement there that God said, I want to send you to bring, you know, light basically into the darkness and also turn people from the power of Satan to God. And of course, he was not disobedient to that heavenly vision. And that's our part today. We work in concert, in partnership with God. It's essential, not an option. It's a directive to take the gospel, not an elective. It's a commandment. It's not a suggestion. Now, I want to correct something. Francis of Assisi, error. You've probably heard this. Well, you know, Francis said, "Preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words." He never said that. That's non-existent, and it holds people back from sharing. They say, well, I just live a good life. And you know, another error that has gotten in that holds people back, God predestines people for heaven and hell, salvation, reprobation. So we don't need to evangelize. There's nothing we can do. God is sovereign. God is sovereign, and he takes his initiative. And, you know, Jesus said, no man come to me except the Father draw him. But the Holy Spirit brings conviction and a quickening, and that accompanies the proclamation of God's word. In Romans chapter 10, and I want you to just look me in the eye. This is very important here. Here's what it says for you and me. It says, how can we call upon him in whom we have not believed? And how can we believe in whom we have not heard? And how can we hear unless somebody is sent? How beautiful are the feet of those that bring the good news. Now, I want to read something to you from the Message translation, because that underscores the importance of being sent. And that's God's message for us. Listen to these words from the Message paraphrase. It says, no one who trusts God like this, heart and soul, will ever regret it. It's exactly the same no matter what a person's religious background may be. The same God for all of us, acting the same incredibly generous way to everyone who calls out for help. Everyone who calls, help God, gets help. But how can people call for help if they don't know who to trust? And how can they know who to trust if they haven't heard of the one who can be trusted? And how can they hear if nobody tells them? And how is anyone going to tell them unless someone is sent to do it? That's why Scripture exclaims, a sight to take your breath away, grand processions of people telling all the good things of God. So this is what we're called to do. And the gospel is good news. And when people realize they're in peril and facing God's judgment and wrath for our sins, that he took then the punishment, we can be pardoned. Martin Luther King Jr. is one of my heroes, and I have a poster where he talks, and I'll put it right on the screen for you to see. This, every day I see it, that, you know, hate doesn't drive out hate, only love can. And darkness can't drive out darkness, only what? Light can. And we bring the light, we're his ambassadors. Number two, God's message through us to humankind. So God has a message to us to be sent, but then through us to humankind. Now I have found, I've traveled to about 30 different nations, and I have found every person has three basic needs. And you can capitalize on this when you're sharing with people and engaging. People have a need for transcendence. In other words, something outside of themselves. They're reaching into the heavens to some God or whoever it is. Number two, people have a need for relationship, community, friendship. They don't want, no man lives to himself, the scripture says. And then the third need is purpose. Everyone has a need for purpose. They want their life to count. Blaise Pascal, brilliant philosopher, said there's a God-shaped vacuum in the heart of every human being that cannot be filled by any human thing, but only by the Creator himself in the person of Jesus Christ. So we want to help people discover relationship with God, an abundant life, freedom from sin, and prepare them for eternity. You know, when Billy Graham died, I had the honor and the privilege to be able to go to the memorial, the tribute, and you know what? Billy was still evangelizing. It was amazing even after he died. Everyone was given this program there. And listen, I'm going to read to you what it says. This is the program, and it says this. Billy says, my hope for you. The Bible has much to say about the brevity of life and the necessity of preparing for eternity. Are you prepared to stand before God? And then Billy lists here, even though he went to heaven, he says you need to confess you're a sinner. You've broken God's law. And that you're willing to turn, that's repentance from your sin. And then you need to ask him to forgive you. And then you trust and believe that Jesus died for you on the cross and rose again. That's his saving work. And then surrender yourself to the Lord Jesus and let him come into your life and change you. With all my heart, Billy ended by saying, I want to leave you with the truth found in the hope that Jesus Christ offers. God loves you. He wants you to spend eternity with him. And I pray that you will make this important decision today. That was Billy saying it. And you know what Billy said? Listen to this. He said, my one purpose in life, one purpose is to help people find relationship with God through the person of Jesus Christ. And that we can identify with. I know that's your heart. So we've got to learn a simple, clear presentation of the gospel. And then also, what's the response? Now, I'm going to give you something here that I love. I have a friend, Rice Brooks, and Rice Brooks put this together. You could memorize this. The gospel is the good news that God became man in Jesus Christ. And he lived the life that we should have lived without sinning. And he died the death that we should have died in our place. And then he rose from the dead 3 days later, just as he said. And he offers forgiveness, abundant and eternal life to everyone who repents and puts their trust in him alone as their Lord and Savior. Memorize it. That's great. Now, to share the message, we need help. We need tools. Just like a plumber has to have his tools. Well, we're Christians. We can't just go out there and say, well, hey, praise God. God loves you. And, and then we stammer and we're tongue-tied and we get lockjaw. We don't know what to say. And there are helps today. Campus Crew is a tremendous ministry. And they have a little booklet. It's called The Four Spiritual Laws. I would encourage you. God loves you. He's got a plan for your life. Why aren't people experiencing it? Because we've all sinned. We've broken God's laws. We're separated. God sent his son, died on a cross in our place. And it's not enough to say, I know it. I have to put action to this by putting my trust in Jesus as my Lord and Savior. It's simply this. Our salvation is what? It's through by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Now, there's also the Christian Equippers resource. They've got the two question quiz. You can look these up and get some of these tools. Or how about Rice Brooks, I mentioned, he has the God test. How about the Navigators? They've got the Bridge to Life. It's a great way to lead somebody to Christ. How about Evangelism Explosion? I love this one. Now, listen to this. Now, look me in the eye. This is good. They say, ask people two questions. I've done this for, 46 years. You say to somebody that you have a relationship with, you say, hey, Jim, you know what? Could I ask you something? Have you come to the place in your spiritual life where you know for certain if you die tonight that you'd go to heaven? Do you know? And, you know, most people say, I don't know, or I hope so, and I think so. And so then you say, well, could I ask you a second question and bring us some clarity? And that you say this, suppose you were to die and you stood before God and he said, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you say? Now, what I found, and listen, as soon as people say, I tried to live a good life. I was baptized. I go to church. I believe in God. Whatever. They're missing it because salvation is not by what we do. It's what he did for us. See, I was raised Catholic. I didn't know that. My wife, she didn't know that. It's his finished work. It's what Jesus did. And when we put our trust totally in him and what he accomplished on Calvary, acknowledging we can't save ourselves. And then there's an exchange. And when we say, Jesus, come in your life, we're talking of his spirit coming in, that we're reborn. And we'll be talking a little more about that as we go. Now, in 1 Peter 3, it says, always be ready to give an answer to every man who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, but do it with gentleness and fear. C.S. Lewis, you know what? He heard the gospel as he was talking with J.R. Tolkien. You've probably heard or seen the film, Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe, etc. And then he prayed to receive Christ walking to the zoo with his brother. But see, he had to hear the gospel. It wasn't, well, just God's sovereign and don't give an invitation and don't talk. God just does it. You know, Billy Graham, he was invited as a young man by a friend of his to a Christian service. The friend even said, you want to drive the car? And Billy heard the gospel and he came to faith, praying to receive Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. How about actor Denzel Washington? I love some of these actors, or Jim Caviezel. At 20, Denzel was kicked out of school. Did you know that? And then he was in some salon, a beauty salon with his mom or grandma or something. And a grandma wrote him a prophecy that he would one day going to travel the world and reach millions of people. Well, when he heard the gospel and yielded his life to Christ, you see the fruit of that. My wife, Doris, she was raised Catholic, and yet, you know what? She became an atheist. She was deceived, and she got into a wayward path until somebody shared the gospel with her. And here's the good news. Listen to this. The very first time she heard a clear gospel presentation, she repented, and she put her trust in Jesus Christ. Now, I don't know where you're at today, but we want to prepare. And these are some resources and tools. And this video is something, I say this, Pastor, you might cut your worship back for 5-10 minutes and maybe your sermon. You could show this to your people for 5 Sundays in a row and equip them. Or you could use your Bible study or maybe with your family. This is to help you. And I simply say this, you know what? I've had people say, well, you know what, Larry, what you're doing is very kind of childlike and elementary. This is good for people that are baby Christians to go share their faith. It's kind of like, you know, here it is, you know, this is pablum, this is for the baby, but we mature, we come into deep teaching and we don't need to tell people about Jesus and share the gospel. Hey folks, that's error and that's heretical. Jesus says to you and me today, go into all the world and let's bring the gospel to a needy world. Well, let's land this plane with some real life testimonies because I'm drawn from 46 years of life and ministry. And these are life lessons to inspire you. Because you know, the devil lies to us that we can't do this and we don't have the ability and this is supposed to be for the evangelists. And no, we're going to learn that the reason the early church had such explosive impact, overturning the Roman Empire within the first 300 years, was because everybody was involved in evangelizing. If you came into my home, into my study, you would see I have a baseball. It's a treasure. I love baseball. And you know what it says here? Larry, pray for me. Pete Rose. Pete Rose is the all-time hit leader in the history of baseball. You maybe see him on ESPN or in a ball game, you know, sometimes as a commentator. But he asked, Larry, pray for me. Well, I know that Pete Rose needs to hear a clear presentation of the gospel for him to totally yield his life to Jesus Christ. You might say, well, I think he has. Well, I sure hope so. But remember what was said. How can we call upon him in whom we have not believed? And how can we believe in him in whom we have not heard? And how can we hear unless someone sent? How beautiful are the feet of those that bring the good news. That's us. We're his ambassadors. You know, when I graduated from Cleveland State University, I was selected for a job right across the street from the White House. And I worked at the AFL-CIO headquarters, the labor unions. And I determined, because I was a young Christian, but I knew the basics of sharing the gospel and the message as we're talking. And you know what? During the course of my 9-month internship, I looked for ways to honor people, serve people. I remembered their birthdays. I got flowers for somebody on an anniversary. And I believe I made an impact. Well, the director of the department was a Jewish man that I deeply respected. He was a brilliant man. And on the last day that I was going to work there, I remember I sat with him in his office and I talked to him. And I had given him a book by a Messianic Jew. And then we discussed, you know, salvation. And he said, well, Larry, I just don't see anything really different among Christians. If I did, I think I'd want to, you know, be one. So, you know what? Listen to this. I had given him the book. I prayed that day and I said, well, I want to be that authentic Christian. And I hope I've set a good example in this office. And he said, you sure did. In fact, you know, the last day in the office, you know what I did? Listen to this. I took our whole office. There was about 8, I think, or 9 people. I took them out to an expensive restaurant, Peking Duck, I think that was the name. And I treated them. And then at the end, I shared how thankful I was to work there. I shared the gospel. And you know what? Somebody stood up and said, Larry, you've been a credit to this department and we should have taken you out. When I left, I felt that the sweet smelling fragrance aroma of Jesus was left there. Get this though. It was a couple years later, a man named Sid Roth, he has a TV program, it's Supernatural. Sid is a longtime friend from 40 years ago. And Sid said, Larry, you won't believe this. I was on a plane and I was sitting there reading my Bible and a man was sitting next to me and he inquired about what I was reading. Well, I shared with him my testimony and everything. And then he said this to me. He said, you know what? We had a guy that worked in our office. He was very much like you. He talked about how Jesus was the Messiah, transformed his life. You know what? He said, wait a minute. Sid says, Larry Tomczak? He said, yeah, that's the guy. That's the guy. Sid built upon that. And then he got the address and he sent my boss in that department his testimony, his book. Now you say, whatever happened? You know what? Shortly thereafter, I believe it was that the director passed away. And all I can say is, I was faithful to bring the message. Sid was faithful. You're meeting people in your neighborhood, at your office, at your school. That's your private world, and we're going to talk about that. But see, this is the adventure and the excitement of lifestyle evangelism, God working through you and me.